So good morning, everybody, and welcome to our service of worship this morning. The only announcements I have is that if you are a member of session, we're going to have a session meeting this Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, and that will be by Zoom. And of course, our Bible study will continue Wednesday morning at 10 a.m., and I will send out a Zoom link for that as well. The peace of God be with you, and also with you. Please join me for our call to worship. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, let us worship God.
Hallelujah.
Let us pray. God of our lives, we ponder the wonder of your creation. We know that all of life begins with your seed, your creative power, your command. And for that, we are truly grateful. We give you thanks for your care for us and for the mercy and grace that make new life possible. To you, we owe all praise and glory. In Jesus' name, amen. And this is love, not that we first loved God, but that God first loved us. And so we approach God boldly, first confessing our sins silently, and then joining together in our unison prayer of confession. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you. We haven't always sought justice. We haven't always offered mercy. We haven't always worshiped you fully. We so easily separate ourselves from you and from one another. Forgive us, O God. Set us free from the past that we can't change, and open us up to a future that is filled with possibility. Help us to live holy, just, and humble lives, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Hi, everyone. You know, at 26 years old, I still love to watch the show VeggieTales. And one of my favorite episodes is about Queen Esther. Now, I'm not going to give you the full story because we're going to talk about this in Sunday school at 11 o'clock, but I'll give you the gist of what happens. You see, Esther was just a normal Jewish woman who became queen, followed God's guidance, and helped the Jewish people stay out of harm. But Esther didn't want to do all of this in the beginning. She was content right where she was and wasn't expecting God to take her out of her comfort zone. But when he did, she followed and did amazing things. Maybe you've been there before, or you're there right now. You're comfortable right where you are, and you don't want God to take you out of your comfort zone. But I encourage each one of us that if God calls us to do something, big or small, that we follow, because we can watch him do extraordinary things through us for other people and for the kingdom of God. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for Esther and her example for us. Help us to follow the call you have on our lives. Amen.
Our reading from the Old Testament this morning is from the book of Esther, in the third, fourth chapters of Esther, and I'm going to be reading selections from these chapters. Sarah's already given you the gist of the story, and now I'm going to hone in on these verses about Haman, and who is the right-hand man, I would say, of the king in Persia, and what happens between him and Mordecai, and how that leads to Esther's rise to do something for her people. Haman said to King Ahasuerus, "There's a certain people scattered and separated among the peoples in all the provinces of your kingdom. Their laws are different from those of every other people, and they do not keep the king's laws, so that is not appropriate for the king to tolerate them. If it pleases the king, let a decree be issued for their destruction, and I will pay 10,000 talents of silver into the hands of those who have charge of the king's businesses, so that they may be put into the king's treasuries. So the king took his signet ring from his hand and gave it to Haman, the enemy of the Jews. When Mordecai learned all that had been done, Mordecai tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes, and went through the city wailing with a loud and bitter cry. He went up to the entrance of the king's gate, for no one might enter the king's gate clothed with sackcloth. When Esther's maids and her eunuchs came and told her the queen was deeply distressed, she sent garments to clothe Mordecai so that he might take off his sackcloth, but he wouldn't accept them. Then Esther called for Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs, who had been appointed to attend her, and ordered him to go to Mordecai to learn what was happening and why. Hathach went out to Mordecai in the open square of the city, in front of the king's gate, and Mordecai told him all that had happened to him, and the exact sum of money that Haman had promised to pay into the king's treasuries for the destruction of the Jews. Mordecai also gave him a copy of the written decree issued in Susa for their destruction, that he might show it to Esther, explain it to her, and charge her to go to the king to make supplication to him and entreat him for her people. Hathach went and told Esther what Mordecai had said. Then Esther spoke to Hathach and gave him a message for Mordecai, saying, "All the king's servants and the people of the king's provinces know that if any man or woman goes to the king inside the inner court without being called, there is but one law. All alike are to be put to death. Only if the king holds out the golden scepter to someone, may that person live. And I myself have not been called to come to the king for 30 days. When they told Mordecai what Esther had said, Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, "Do you think that in the king's palace you will be able to escape more than all the other Jews? For if you keep silence at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another quarter, but you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for just such a time as this." Then Esther said in reply to Mordecai, "Go and gather all the Jews to be found in Susa and hold a fast on my behalf and neither eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maids will also fast as you do. After that, I will go to the king, though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For Lord, you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Throughout our life, I think we gain glimpses of insight into who we are and who we are supposed to be. We begin life and we're filled with hopes and dreams for the future, but life never goes according to our plans. There are ebbs and flows, there are joys and sorrows, there are good things and bad things that come our way. We move, we change careers, we get married, we raise a family, and our life can seem fragmented and disjointed at times, almost like putting pieces of a puzzle together that don't seem to quite fit. But sometimes in hindsight, we can gain fresh perspective. 5 or 10 years pass, and we look back on our experiences, and suddenly we can see them all come together into a bigger picture. And we realize that life isn't just a series of random events, but that God has a plan and purpose for our lives. And we'll have an epiphany of sorts, and it can change everything we do going forward. Let me tell you a little bit about how that happened for me. After college, I worked in the insurance industry for about 12 years and then at the national headquarters of the American Baptist Churches. I had gone on at night and gotten my MBA, and then from that was able to become the marketing director of both places I had worked. And after having children, I was able to work part-time, and that seemed to be perfect for a mother of 3 small children. But I was also an active member of Wallingford Presbyterian Church. I'd become good friends with its associate pastor. We were about the same age. We had children within months of each other. and our friendship grew. And as it grew, so did my faith. And I grew restless to do more than just market products and services. So when she moved to Illinois, I felt this deep void, both personally and also spiritually. And there I was sitting in the pew on the first Sunday after she had left. And I knew I was being called to rise up and follow in her footsteps. What I find so remarkable about this story of Esther and her ability to follow God's call is that she had no role models, no woman to blaze the trail before her, no one to show her what was possible. In fact, the previous queen, we are told in the story, is done away with for her insubordination. How do you follow that? Very cautiously, I suspect. Well, to put the story in context, before Esther was queen, there was another queen, the queen who was banished, and her name was Vashti. And the king was Xerxes of Persia, also known as Ahasuerus. The Hebrew people were in exile. First, they were defeated by the Babylonians and then by the Persians, and they were all under the rule of this king. The king liked to party a lot. And he hosted one party that went so well that he decided to host another one, and this time have it go over a 7-day duration. And he invited all of the prominent people in the kingdom to this party. It was a week-long fraternity party filled with nonstop drinking and revelry. How could he top this, he wondered. How could he display even more of his power and possessions? And then it struck him. He would invite Queen Vashti to come, wearing her crown, and her crown only, according to the Hebrew text. She'd dance for them. She would be the icing on the cake at the end of the week. But Vashti had scruples, and she refused to do it. At the insistence of the king's advisors, Vashti is banished. After all, they said, just imagine if all the wives refused to do what their husbands demanded of them. Well, needless to say, the king agrees, and now he needs a new queen. And like Prince Charming looking for his princess, he scouts around the kingdom, and his eyes fall on Esther, and she is chosen. It's a dream come true for a Jewish woman who has no stature in a foreign and godless land. And Mordecai, Esther's guardian, reluctantly lets her go. But fairy tales are never without their dark side. The king had a high-ranking officer whom he trusted completely, Haman, who was manipulative, narcissistic, power-hungry, and he hated anyone who threatened his position. So Haman asked the king to enact a law that anybody he would pass by would have to bow to him, pay him homage. And the king complies. But when he passes by Mordecai, Mordecai refuses to bow. He isn't going to pay homage to anyone except God alone. And Haman is furious. So Haman goes back to the king and hatches a plot to destroy Mordecai and all of the Jews in the kingdom. He tells them they're a threat to the Persian Empire and throws in some money to sweeten the deal. And money talks. And the king gives Haman permission to set a date for their execution. Esther's coveted life as the queen of Persia is suddenly in jeopardy. How quickly a dream can be shattered. We know that all too well. We all have had dreams that didn't materialize. We've even had dreams that did materialize, but that didn't turn out the way we thought they would. But I still believe in dreams, and I hope you do too, because I believe God is in our dreams when we invite God to be present, and if we give God the freedom to direct those dreams when our dreams don't match those of God's. Should I enter seminary? Or should I do the practical thing, the sensible thing, and forget the idea ever entered into my mind? Should you change careers, move, retire, start a new project, do something you've always wanted to do, but you haven't had the courage to verbalize it to anyone? Haman cast pur, or lots, as they were called, to choose a date for the annihilation of all the Jews, and he erects a scaffold intended exclusively for Mordecai. But Esther's clueless about the edict. She's tucked away behind the palace walls. So Mordecai leaps into action. He hopes she has an inside track to the king, although we all remember what happened to Queen Vashti. Well, Mordecai tells Esther she needs to intercede. Who knows, he asks, maybe you've been put in the palace for such a time as this. But Esther isn't convinced. To see the king, no matter who you are, required an invitation. You wouldn't dare to go into the king without one because you could be killed. And Esther reminds Mordecai of that. But Mordecai reminds Esther that the future of her people rests in her hands. This is your calling. This is why you're here. This is the meaning of your whole life. And it all depends on how you'll respond, he tells her. Nothing like a little pressure on a 15-year-old girl. But it always is a struggle, isn't it? To take that first step. Who, me? Do I really have what it takes? Can I really succeed? At first, Esther can't imagine being much help at all, and she wrestles with her decision. But finally, she concedes and says, if I die, I die. And then she gets to work on a strategy to save her people. And the strategy is brilliant. She tells Mordecai to gather all the Jews together and to fast and pray for 3 days. And then, knowing the king's proclivity for parties, she throws him a doozy. And when he asks how to repay her, she says, let me throw you another party, a better one. And this time bring Haman with you. And the king enjoys this party too, and is so taken with Esther's apparent desire for him that he offers her anything, even half the kingdom. And that's when she drops the bombshell. She reveals her Jewish heritage and Haman's plot to destroy her and her people. The king's outrage and confused, and he runs from the room in order to take some time to think things over. Haman is terrified, and he throws himself at Esther's feet, begging for mercy. Then when the king returns, he assumes Haman is making a play for his wife and executes him on the same gallows that Haman had erected for Mordecai. Mordecai is rewarded with wealth and power, and the festival of Purim, the festival of lots, is celebrated annually by the Jewish people to remember the time that Esther saved her people from destruction. Esther was a reluctant hero. As a woman of that time, she was virtually powerless, but she did what she could, and that's all Mordecai asked of her. And of course, that's all God asks of us. Winston Churchill once said something that has stuck with me. He said, in every age, there comes a time when a leader must come forward to meet the needs of the hour. Therefore, there's no potential leader who does not have the opportunity to make a positive difference in society. We are all potential leaders, Churchill reminds us, whether we recognize it or not. God not only has a place for us, but has placed us where God needs us for such a time as this. And the decision is ours as to whether we will do what we can where we are. As I wrestled with my sense of call and whether or not to begin seminary, I stumbled across an excerpt from a book called Your Heart's Desire, by Emmett Fox. It was a devotional that I was given by the very pastor whose footsteps I felt compelled to follow. And whenever I feel stuck, I turn back to this passage and reread it again. It never fails to stir my heart. He says, How is one to find his true place in life? Is there any means whereby you may discover what it is that God really wants you to do? You may feel inclined to say, even if it's true that God wishes me to do something, how can I possibly find out what it is? Perhaps you'll even be tempted to add, I'm a very plain, everyday sort of person. My circumstances are extremely restricted. How then can there be something beautiful, wonderful, splendid awaiting me? Or even if there were, how could I possibly get to know about it? Well, the answer is divinely simple, he says. God has whispered into your heart that very thing, whatever it is, that God wants you to be and do and have. And that wonderful thing is nothing less than your heart's desire, nothing less than that. And the birth of that marvelous wish in your soul, the dawning of that secret dream, is the voice of God telling you to rise up and follow, because God has need of you. God has need of you. At its core, that's what the story of Esther is about. And that's what our story is about too. It's about listening to how God wants to use us and prayerfully wrestling with that call and then moving forward faithfully to fulfill God's plan for us. Each day we're called to seek justice, to show mercy, to walk humbly with our God. Each day we're called to speak out on another's behalf or to love one another with the kind of love that Christ first showed us, and make decisions that impact not just us, but those we encounter every place we go. Even small decisions can have a tremendous impact, and unspectacular people can change the future of a nation, even of a church. Esther has shown us that. So for such a time as this, may we too rise up and follow. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us lift our hearts up to God in prayer. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Gracious God, we celebrate the glimpses that you give us in Scripture of who you are and who we are in relation to you. And Lord, we marvel at a love so broad and deep that you accept us as we are in all our humanity and frailty. How grateful we are for your infinite mercy and grace. We know that you have a grand design for our lives, and so help us fulfill our calling as your people. Give us hearts for discipleship, that through us your will would be done and your kingdom would be glorified. Gather us close when the storms of life scatter us, losses scar us, setbacks disappoint us, and anxieties and worries immobilize us. Sustain those who are struggling with illness, with slow recoveries, with pending surgery, with wounded spirits, and those who we lift up to you now in the silence of our hearts. O Lord, pour your healing power through broken bodies and wounded souls, and provide energy and hope for the days ahead. And Lord, we pray for our leaders as well. Help the nations of this world find a way to live together in peace and honor and integrity. And show us all how we might bridge the gap between wealth and poverty, plenty and hunger, and settle differences based on love rather than pride. In a world in which lives have become scorecards and where points earned measure individual worth, give all of us the faith to place our trust in your wisdom and grace, remembering that even though he was in the form of God, Christ emptied himself and took the form of a servant and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. And therefore God highly exalted him so that at his name every knee would bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord, to the glory of God. Together we pray all of these things in the name of the one who taught us how to pray, as we now join together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all of our understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in the love of God, and in God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And may the blessing of God our Creator, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit, our Sustainer, be with you all, now and forevermore. Amen.